Good evening. Welcome to As I See It, A Blind Woman's View. Thank you for tuning in tonight. My name is Andrea Giudice. I am your host. And with me is my guide dog, who, as always, I do not introduce by name, for his focus and our safety as a team. Thanks so much for tuning in. This is another installment in the series Pup and Person to Partners, except it's really supposed to be Person and Pup to Partners. And I have some wonderful guests with me tonight who are going to be talking about another path that some of the puppies, like the puppies we saw with Karen, might take instead of becoming a guide dog. I'm so glad that you're tuning in this evening. This series has been so exciting for me to do. We started with talking to someone who was raising a puppy to become a guide dog. And she had with her a very young puppy who had just started with her. He was about 10 weeks old. And a dog who was about to go into training, who by this point has probably completed her training and may already be working with someone. We talked to a mobility instructor about what the person needs to get ready to do to be ready to have a guide dog. We talked to a guide dog instructor about what the training is involved with for a dog to become knowledgeable about how to wear a harness and what all of those commands mean and what it means to be someone's eyes. And we've talked a lot to me about my personal opinions about and feelings about being a guide dog user and getting ready to go to guide dog school and coming home and making that adjustment. In fact, probably more than anyone ever wanted to see me interview myself. And so another piece in this important process and conversation of person and pup to partners is, what about the dogs that don't become guide dogs? There are a lot of dogs that for many, many reasons don't become guide dogs. And a word that I absolutely don't ever want to hear is that they failed. They didn't fail. They simply did not become guide dogs. And I don't know how many of you might have gone to college to be something and decided halfway through that that was absolutely nothing you could ever imagine being and decided to do a different thing. So there are a lot of reasons why a dog might not become a guide dog. And some of them could be as simple as car sickness. A guide dog cannot get car sick because they're going to be riding on buses and trains and planes and in cars and taxis. And that would be very, very disruptive and not something that would be compatible with being a working guide dog. As a pet, that probably wouldn't be such a big deal. They might go in the, you know, they could avoid car rides and it wouldn't affect their ability to have the job as a pet. But sometimes it's just that a guide dog isn't the right work for them. So some of the things that make a guide dog, some of the characteristics that are perfect for guide dog work may not be perfect for another kind of service dog and vice versa. So a dog that has characteristics that may be counterintuitive to becoming a guide might mean that it would be fabulous as a service dog for someone in a wheelchair or a hearing dog for someone who's deaf. It might also mean that it could work really well in search and rescue, in detection work, in protection work, in the military, but like being a police dog. So there's all these different careers that happen aside from being a guide dog. And every dog that's here with me tonight has either been a guide dog and is now retired, or was bred to be a guide dog, bred by a guide dog school, but has a different career now. The reason that I have invited the guests here tonight is because I want to talk to each of them about how it is that they are now partnered with the dog next to them. And I'm going to start talking about retirement. Many, 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 many people stop me and they say, and they've got such devastation in their voice, what happens when he retires? Do they kill him? And I say, oh no, there's a special recipe. No, it's very sacred ceremony. So a lot of people don't know what happens when a guide dog retires. And so that's why I want to talk about that a little bit and then introduce George and the dog that he's with, because that is a retired guide dog. When a guide dog is ready to retire, and in an ideal world, they will have worked 8-10 years. They're now definitely ready for retirement. We all deserve to retire when we get to be a senior citizen. And it's time for them to make that transition. And there are a lot of options. Sometimes the dog will stay with their handler. So in the past, I have kept a retired guide dog and gone on to get a successor guide dog, and they've all lived very happily in the same house. But that's not always an option or even the right choice for the person or the dog. Sometimes the person who's partnered with the guide dog will have a friend or family member who they know right off the bat, this is a great place for my dog to go. It's a perfect situation. It's the exact right placement. Sometimes there isn't the right placement, and it's not because you don't respect or love your family. When my first dog retired, I was in college, and there were friends that I had that lived near campus, and they wanted her. And when I said that I didn't think that was the right thing, they never talked to me again. It wasn't that they weren't worthy of her. It was that it just wasn't the right situation for her or for me. So sometimes the puppy goes back to its raiser, and that's great when that can happen. Sometimes raisers get dogs back that they raised, you know, 10 years ago, and the dog comes back and remembers all the rules of the house. It's really interesting, actually. In the instance of the dog that we have here, this dog actually was my brother's guide dog, so it's kind of like having my nephew here. And he stayed at home with my brother for about a year, and then my brother's living situation changed, and it was no longer appropriate for him to have an active guide dog and a retired guide dog. And through a wonderful set of circumstances, we came upon George and Linda, and they have him now. And he's got this fabulous retirement house and this retirement parents, and it's just a fabulous situation. So I would like to have, we'll have George talk about that experience. In the instance of Don, who's sitting next to me, he's got a dog that he raised to be a guide dog. She didn't make it in that program, and now she's a service dog. And at the far end of my little band of dogs and humans here, I have Steph, who has a dog that she's training professionally in a totally different career. Also a dog that was bred and raised to be a guide dog, wasn't suited to that particular career, but now has found a new one. So I'm just thank you all so much for coming. And George, let's start with you and talk a little bit if you want, if you will. And if you won't, then I'll have to, you know, not give you treats. about how it has been for you with Euro. I did it. I'm sorry. I wasn't going to use your dog's name. How it is with you with the dog that you have, and how that's been, and how that experience has been for you.
Well, I can say just one thing is it's wonderful to have him. He definitely filled a void in my life. And he comes to work with me every day. I'm a locksmith. And he greets the people as they come in, and they love him. And
the important thing of helping him to continue to have a purpose, even though he's not a guide dog anymore. It's not that he just he's not ready to have no job.
Well, so if I could teach him how to work a screwdriver.
Yeah, give that dog enough food and he might just do it. that's great. That's wonderful for him to have that, still having the routine of going to work and things that he used to have. We'll get to you, sweet girl, I promise.
Yeah, he likes swimming and he likes his ball, and I try to get him to exercise, and we have alpacas also, and in the evening when we clean and stuff, there's one alpaca that she follows Euro around and stuff, and she just loves Euro, you know, and Euro tries to walk around and leave her and stuff, but he has his own personality, and he's quite a dog, and I'm so lucky to have him.
No.
I'm so glad that he found you guys. I was very honored to play a part in the transfer of Euro from his home with my brother to his new retirement home. It's a big change, and it was really, for me, a huge honor to be a part of that and to get to know you guys and to know that he's just so happy in his new life and getting so spoiled and not having to have the stress of guiding someone anymore, but still having routine and things that he does in this fabulous retirement life that he has.
He likes coming, going to work with me and stuff. And if 8:30 comes around and I'm not out the door, he lets me know, hey, it's time to go to work. You know? And
We'll get to you, sweet girl, I promise. You know,
He comes on service calls with me. He rides around, and he loves the vehicle and stuff. I mean, he does.
He's exchanged his harness for a van.
Yes,
basically. That's perfect.
Oh yeah,
that's awesome.
He's got his own personal spot, and
And not spoiled at all, I'm sure.
No, he's not. No,
he's a good boy.
Oh yeah, he's a good one. I brush him out every day, and he still sheds like crazy.
Yeah, he's. That's what they do. They're good at it.
You can see how.
We'll have to get you to spin his hair.
Well, I'm trying to get enough to give Nick a pillow.
Yeah, I know. Nick wants to stuff a pillow with his hair. I'm so glad that you could come tonight. And Dawn, let's talk to you about your girl for a minute. You were a foster parent for a guide dog program.
Yes.
And tell me about how that all happened.
Well, I had done a dog for them 20 years prior, so I knew what it entailed, and are we not using their name?
Is that, no, you're, no, this is your choice.
Okay.
You can use, I just, I
I'm
try
sure
not to
use sure blue with mine.
Yeah, I know. I'm surprised I haven't done it with my own dog yet, so.
No, I mean the name of the organization.
Oh, you can do that too. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Well, she's actually a Fidelco guide dog, and we signed up with them, and they told us to be prepared, have a name for, because they go through the alphabet, have a name for a Q, male and female, and a P, male. So we picked through names, we took 2 weeks, and we had all these names, we're all set. Three names that we definitely wanted when we get there. And they said, well, they have a dog at home, so we had to switch, and now you have a female from the P letter. That was the only one we didn't have. So I said, well, how about Portia? No, somebody else has her. You can't have that one. I said, how about Portia, P-O-R-T-I-A? No, that's confusing. I said, fine, how about PETA? Oh, yeah, you can have that one. So P-I-T-A, pain in the... Yep. But that was before we even met her. But she's been a delight. She stayed with us for a year and a half. Then she went back to the program, and actually Steph was working at the program at the time and remembered her, which was amazing to me. She wasn't cut out for that career, so we got her back. And as my wife's illness has progressed, she's now in a wheelchair and can't walk and can't reach. And she can't hit buttons and switches and things. So PETA has been trained. That's my dog's name, PETA. We trained her to open and close doors, turn lights on and off, touch elevator buttons or handicap buttons. She'll pick something up and give it back to you if you drop it. She's very alert for visitors coming down the driveway, and she's a big help to my wife.
And she would accompany your wife out as well when she goes out.
Yeah.
So it's not just at home.
Yeah, when she was in the manual chair, she'd actually put the harness on her and hold her and the command pull, and she would pull her through the grocery store.
It's awesome. So cool. And that's, I think it's so wonderful to think about how whatever it was that caused PETA to not be suited to guide work didn't in any way mean that she wasn't suited to work. And that you guys were able to, it just happened to be that you got her back and figured out, oh, she can do this and she wants to do this.
Yeah.
And I just, that's so fabulous.
Yeah, she's 7 and a half now, and she has a lot more useful years in her, and it's working out great.
That's awesome. A lot of the guide dog schools will work in partnership with other service dog programs. The guide dog school that my dog was trained at, a lot of their puppies go to, it's Guide Dogs for the Blind, it's in California. A lot of the dogs go to the hearing dog program in San Francisco. A lot of them go to Dogs for Diabetics, which is also a California-based school, and to Canine Companions for Independence, which is a service dog school. So a lot, and some of those dogs will come to guide dogs. Like they'll be like, this dog is really, really, we think, greatly suited for guide work, but just doesn't have what we're looking for this particular career. And so that will go back and forth, which is awesome. And then sometimes it's not service to an individual with a disability that's the right calling. A lot of times it is a different kind of job. For example, a dog that is really, really, really focused on sniffing things might be a really good dog for search and rescue or detection work. A dog that has I can't give you other examples because that's not my forte, but that's why I have Steph here, because she is working with an organization and can tell you a lot more about that, but working with detection dogs. But again, the dog that she has with her tonight was raised to be a guide dog. It went through, it was bred and raised in that, with that intent. The realization was there that that dog is not going to make it as a guide dog, but instead of not that there's anything wrong with the job of being a pet. That's not what I'm here to say. But some dogs want to do more than be a pet and can't be a guide dog, so there are other options. So tell us a little bit about you, Steph, and the dog that you have with you.
Okay. Currently, I work with MSA Security, and we specialize in explosive detection canines.
Does that mean that the dogs are explosive?
Yeah. Some days it feels that way.
It depends on what they had for dinner.
So, yes, I think sometimes there's, you can also say bomb detection dog, mm-hmm. but I think explosive detection is important because it's not always a bomb they're searching for.
Right.
You know, so you want to break down all those components of what could be in a bomb so that they know each of those components separately. So that's why we say explosives. So sometimes they're grouped together, sometimes they're individual. Our program, what's very interesting about our program as a detection program is the majority of our dogs come from service dog or guide dog schools.
Interesting.
All over the country. So we work with Fidelco. We work with the Seeing Eye, Guiding Eyes, Guide Dog Foundation, Southeastern, Freedom Guide Dogs, Guide Dogs of America, and Canine Companions.
Well, so you're talking California, Florida, New Jersey, New York.
Yeah, we've had dogs, yeah. especially from Canine Companions, come from Florida, Texas, Ohio,
that is awesome.
All over. And all the dogs we find to be very successful in our program. We can't say enough about the work that the puppy raisers put into the dogs and about the breeding of the dogs, the socialization, because we wouldn't be able to do what we do as a detection company if we didn't have, you know, the puppy raisers also supporting our program in the way of if they didn't make the guide dog, they come to us. So we're still looking for all those sociability, confidence, enthusiasm to do the job. And the dog I have with me today is actually a released dog from Freedom Guide Dogs.
Oh, cool.
His name is Xander. And, you know, as you're watching me keep him occupied. So one of the main reasons that dogs will come to us is because they're so busy, especially with his nose. So he's, you know, sniffing the dog next to him. He's sniffing my shoes. He's sniffing the floor. We love that. So the fact that he's doing all that makes him not good for a guide dog.
Right. Because if I had to be managing that, I would never be able to get through my
day. But for us, it's perfect. So for us, we like that busyness because we'll have him on task. He'll be using his nose. He's got lots of energy too. So he's being really silly right now, rolling around. So he's got plenty of energy. Likes his nose. He's very confident. So we look for that. We want them to be comfortable in any environment. We need them to also be really good with people because they're working in environments a lot of times with loud noises, busy environments, lots of people. You can imagine, you know, when you go to New York City, all of that stimulus. We have about 160 teams in New York City right now.
Wow.
So, yeah, they get inundated with the environment. So that's something that we also find that guide dogs are prepared for, therefore helps us with our program.
Now, do you place the dogs that you train, I'm assuming here in Connecticut?
Yes, our training facility is in Windsor, Connecticut.
And do they go all over the country?
They are placed all over the country.
No.
So our program works is they're trained with us for 3 to 4 months or longer if need be. And then our handlers fly from all over the country or drive, depending on where they are. They stay with us in a hotel and come to our campus for 2 weeks and are placed with the dog. And then they go home and kind of like how you'd have a class for a guide dog, they go home and then they go to their locations and continue to develop the skills as a team together on location. So all of our dogs live in homes and are, you know, when they're off time, they're family dogs. They get to have the same perks of being a pet, you know.
And I think I'm really glad you mentioned that because that's something I haven't talked a lot about in this series, and I think it's really important. A lot of misconceptions are out there, and one of them is that that a dog who that works all the time.
Yep.
Whether it's, you know, a service dog or a guide dog or a detection dog, that there's never downtime, because of course whenever someone sees me out and about, they see him in harness. And so they never see him at home being a ridiculous dog, being silly and doing dog things. They only see that working dog. And so it is important to know that it's really critical for dogs to have downtime. And just like all of us wouldn't want to work 24 hours a day, we want to go home and except he doesn't ever get away to get away from his boss because he lives with me. So, but he definitely does play and he's silly. And anyone who's ever met him out of harness knows that he is the most ridiculous dog ever when he's not working. And I think that's part of what makes him such a good worker, is because he does know how to just cut loose and turn it all off. And all of us are better for having time off. And so that's why it's important that dogs do get a chance to not always be working. But it's also fun that, for example, for Xander, and even for all of our dogs, their work, it's not drudgery. They love their work. When he sees his harness, he loves that. When Euro, it's time to go to work with George, Euro's like, yeah, let's do it. When it's time for Peter to work and she puts on her vest, she loves it. Because their work is, they take pride in their work, and it's one of the things that you're looking for in a working dog, is a dog that does take pride in the work that they're doing, and a dog that really enjoys it. I have been working guide dogs for 30 years, and I love the fact that every one of us is using food reward here tonight. 30 years ago, I would have been banned from the world had I publicly used food reward with my dog. It was not done. And it's so much more fun to be, I mean, I know I certainly work better for food than not for food. You want to say, oh, sure, there's cookies at the end of the day. Oh, I'll do a better job. I'll work really well today. So it's wonderful that they can look at their work and go, this is fun. I enjoy my job. I take pride in my job. I know I'm good at my work. And that's why finding the right job for the dog is so important. There's no good that's going to come of forcing a dog to be a guide if that work is not right, or forcing a dog to do detection work if that's not the right job, because they won't do it well, they won't be happy, and therefore they won't be successful. And it's interesting to me, I've known of more than, certainly not many dogs, but certainly there are dogs that go through their training as guides and everything is perfect. They do great work. They pass all their tests. Even when I say to people that the instructors do blindfold, the dogs do blindfold tests. I'm like, they blindfold the dogs? No, they blindfold the instructor to make sure that the dog can do the work for someone who's not using their vision. The dog does great. You hand them to a blind person and they're like, oh no, this is for real. I'm not doing it. No, it was all good when it was academic. But now that it's real, and I don't know how they know. Now that it's real, thank you, I don't want that particular job. That's a lot of responsibility. So a dog might get released from its program when it starts training. It might get released when it finishes training. It might get released not as often, but even when it's a younger puppy. If they just know this dog is so prey-driven, it's never going to be able to really be happy not chasing everything that moves. And that's not going to be effective for a guide dog. So at any point through the program, that as it's being raised, a dog might be released, and that's why I don't like the word flunked, because I don't think none of these dogs are failures. They might have just taken a different path in what the initial intention was. But it's so cool to be able to see all the things that dogs are doing. In the place where I live, they do canine bed bug inspections. Like, dogs come and that's their job. There are dogs that their job is to help detect if someone is having a seizure. There's dogs that detect cancer. It's just amazing how we're learning to harness the strengths of dogs, their intelligence, their nose, their ability to smell, their sense of hearing. It's mind-boggling and I love it. I love that we're all here. And I am so excited that my guests are here tonight who are willing to share their experiences and to put themselves out there into the public to say, yes, these are dogs that this is our life and this is what we do. And it's just great. Steph, do you train these dogs? Do you actually have you been, do you actually do any of the actual detection work, or are you more on the back end of the back side of the, are you on the back end of this job, of the training, and what is your training background?
So currently my position title is canine procurement specialist. So I love what I do. I get to go to the guide dog schools and evaluate dogs and bring them back. So I get to meet Xanders,
all over the place.
Yeah, and bring them back in. I do some of the training because in my position, to be able to select the right dog, you need to understand the training and what goes into them. Mm-hmm. And I'm working right now towards some of the handler skills. I'll sit in some of the classes and do some of the exercises and handle dog so that I can get that experience so I know what the end product looks like. So that's kind of what I mainly do. Not so heavy in training dogs every day, but kind of dabbling with that to do better at my position.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
And continue to grow. My background is I started off as an apprentice and became a certified guide dog trainer instructor. And then from there, I moved on and coordinated a puppy program at a guide dog school. Then from there, I moved on to working with the detection dogs. It was a logical fit for me because it bridged both worlds. In the puppy program, I had to work, you know, when the puppies sometimes were 8 months old, you're looking at a puppy for a career change. Mm-hmm. So I had already kind of had some experience going into what makes a really good detection dog, what makes a good different service dog.
Right.
So coming into this position, it was kind of a natural fit for me. To now go to other schools and kind of do the same thing. So that's currently what I'm doing at MSA. And
that's cool. So given the schools that you mentioned, you're probably working with Shepherds, Labs, Goldens, and Golden Lab crosses.
Yes, I would
from this, obviously there's probably other dogs that you use, but those would be the breeds that you're getting from,
correct,
from the guide
dog
schools.
Correct. I would say 85% of our dogs are Labradors, Goldens, or Lab Golden crosses. Small percentage are Shepherds.
Interesting.
And a lot of them come from Fidelco.
Yeah. Well, there's so many fewer schools using Shepherds in their programs at all that
yep.
you just have a smaller pool anyway, which is a thing. Thank you so much for watching this evening. And because we've had so much fun and such great conversation, I've convinced all of these folks to come back and do this again next month. So don't forget to come back and see how it all turns out. Thanks so much for watching. This is Andrea Giudice with As I See It, A Blind Woman's View. Have a great month.